William Shakespeare once wrote that all the world is a stage, and all men and women are merely players. They have their exits and their entrances. And here, we see an unfortunate woman caught in the grips of pseudo-justice. For if we look at it, it's anything but justice, and it's hardly fair. And just as sugar resembles salt from a distance, when we take a look a bit closer, we understand that this kangaroo court resembles justice, but it's hardly just. The all-male judge and jury convicted this woman of adultery, flagrante delicto, caught in the act. But it takes Jesus to show a different perspective. It takes Jesus to show a different view. Perception has a great deal to do with perspective. Agenda has much to do with motive. When one is capable of understanding someone's perception and how it's skewed by their perspective, then the motive of their agenda becomes quite clear. The perspective of these accusers wasn't just sexism, for they sought to prosecute the woman, and they never punished her partner. Jesus sought to highlight their perspective because his motive was freedom. And it's impossible to engage in true freedom when you're caught in the bondage of patriarchy. Sexism is akin to racism, because it reduces the participants to their demographic. I am a heterosexual man. I am a black man. I am a Christian, but I am more than heterosexual, black, and Christian. And when you reduce me to a demographic, you remove the intrinsic quality that God gave me and cultivates within me. I'm more than what you see. I'm more than the demographics you divide and place me in. I am a reflection of God who created me in God's image, and so are you. The light that only God can give can't be extinguished by humankind. That light burns in the midst of 1,000 midnights. Through the depression in your life, that light burns. Through the tragedies in your life, that light burns. Under the cloaks of patriarchy, poverty, and pain, it continues to shine. And that's what Jesus was attempting to teach. She wasn't a woman to be dominated. She was a human being to be loved, to be understood, to be forgiven. I don't care how many times we tell this story, we can't escape the fact that the rulers of that day spent painstaking hours confronting those whom they should have comforted. The story isn't an indictment on morality, nor is it an editorial in public policy. It's a raw look at an unnerving view of the absence of leadership that majors in minors. The minor issue seemed to outweigh the major issues in that society, and that's no different from our society, where the minor issues seem to outweigh everything that's major, and we concentrate on that which is temporal and at the expense of that which is eternal. The minor issue is the hairstyles our children wear on their heads. But the major issue is the lack of education in their heads. The minor issue is the keto diet versus the Atkins diet. But the major issue is the lack of food available to roughly 70% of the world's population. The minor issue is the $5 billion in funding for a wall we don't need instead of the $700 million to retrofit pipes in the city of Flint for a water program that they desperately need. compassion. Compassion is a key when dealing with humanity. Whether it's economics or academics, compassion is the key. Whether it's law or art, compassion is critical. Without compassion, even the most prudent laws become barbaric. Without compassion, it's possible to speak the Bible and never utter a word of the gospel. I understand the importance of law, but Jesus understood the importance of compassionate government, and he wouldn't let this woman or her accusers attach themselves or entrench themselves to laws that elevate some and decimate others on the basis of gender. This is the first gender equality movement in the modern world. And though we have a long way to go, we can get there with compassion. If you see me crawling on the street, it's biblical to say, if a man doesn't work, he doesn't eat. But it's the gospel that gives that man a plate of food and nourishes his soul by reminding him that God made and formed him in God's image. I need the gospel. In a world that robs the poor of their dignity and the weak of their humanity, we need the gospel. For it's the gospel that makes us feel whole. We need the gospel. Times of depression and in times of terrorism, we need the gospel. When we're fighting over church pews and who sits where and who parks where and who speaks when, we need the gospel because it puts us all on the same level. We're all sinners in need of guidance. We're all those who are recipients of God's love. God's blessing is on all of our lives. That's what the gospel does. It enlivens a cold heart and it allows you to be changed in a world that remains unchanged. We need the gospel. Instead of building bigger prisons and using resources in the world on drugs, our politicians could end the drug war, which disproportionately affects impoverished and minority areas and often results in unnecessarily fatherless children and multi-generational problems that flow from single-parent families. And then I thought, maybe there's a method to the madness. Maybe our politicians won't end the drug war because they profit from it. Maybe they profit in what Michelle Alexander calls the new Jim Crow. Throughout the country, many rural communities are funded by prison economies. And those economies are staffed based on third grade reading scores from students in impoverished areas. Maybe it's by design. The question is whether we'll see the people, black and brown and rich and mostly poor, or will we see them as God sees them, as children of God, ready to be loved and taught? It's an indictment on our society. It's an indictment on every person that reads the gospel. This is a two-edged sword, for I'm not just telling you what I believe, but it calls me to action based on my perspective. Remember, perspective deals with motive. So I have to ask myself, what are my motives? What are my motives in understanding this scripture? What are my motives in delivering this message? What are my motives in understanding how to implement this message so that it carries, that it dwells in your life and in mine? What are our motives? These problems can be prevented by establishing restorative justice examples for non-violent offenders. Community justice conference also involves face-to-face meeting between the victim and the offender. This engages large groups of participants by allowing them to air their grievances, allow the victim and the offender relevant express their feelings and concerns and to get to the bottom of the situation, to have their questions answered. Restorative justice principles are part of the gospel. For restorative justice brings back dignity to those who have been deprived of it. I'm just in the text. I'm just in John 8, verses 8 through 11. Well, that was restorative justice at its finest. The woman's accusers reminded her of her guilt. But Jesus told her about her glory. And someone will always remind you of what you did, what you thought, how you failed. But Jesus will remind you of who you are. In a world that seeks to thrive on that which is negative, we need something that reminds us of who we are intrinsically before everything takes us off kilter. We need to be reminded exactly of who we are, that we're made in the image and likeness of God, that God made us and said it was good, that we are beautifully and wonderfully made. That doesn't take away from the offense, but it comforts the offender knowing that she was not alone in her offense. Restorative justice speaks to the principle and the potential of God's children to be like their Creator. Jesus bent down and he wrote in the sand. And in all my years of studying this scripture, I never figured out just what he wrote. Could it have been a few comforting words to ease her soul? Possibly. Could it have been a mantra to remind her that she was not destined to be at the bottom of society, nor that she was to be subject to her accuser's taunts? Possibly. But this is certain. After he wrote what he did in that sand, he spoke to the woman, and then he spoke directly to her accusers. And how many of you know that God can address your enemies better than you can? The reason I know this is because I've seen it for myself. There was a heavyweight champion by the name of Muhammad Ali. In 1967, he was convicted of draft evasion because he refused entry into the armed forces based on his religious principles. He was convicted and sentenced to 5 years in prison and a $10,000 fine. During the next 3 years, he was out on appeal of that conviction. He was barred from fighting professionally. His popularity sank, and his finances dwindled, but he stood his ground. He understood that he was God's child, and he stood his ground. He spoke in his religious freedom, and he stood his ground. His passion for freedom never wavered. It looked very bleak for him as the courts rolled along very slowly. But I want us to know this morning that justice delayed is not justice denied. For in 1970, his conviction was overturned by the Supreme Court, and he restarted his boxing career, regaining the heavyweight championship of the world approximately 7 years later from George Foreman in Zaire, Africa. He was hated in 1967. Arguably the most hated athlete in the country, if not the world. But in 1996, some 26 years later, the most beloved athlete in the world, Muhammad Ali, was seen carrying the Olympic torch through the streets of Atlanta. He stuck to his guns. God spoke to his accusers. God continues to speak. God continues to speak to you, and God continues to speak to me. In our anguish, God speaks to us to comfort us, knowing that we are not alone in our grief. God speaks to us and comforts us, and I believe Jesus told that woman to look in the sand, but to look up. He told that woman to stop and see the constellations in the sky, and your glory is written in the sky, for if you look up, you'll see Aquarius, the water bearer. And that means that I bore your sins for you, and I pled your case when you couldn't speak a word. Look up. I see Aquila, the mighty eagle, for I am God who sits high and looks low, and I'm able to see your pain, and I'm able to act on your behalf. Look up. I see Aries, the ram, for I am the ram in the bush, and I will fight your battles if you just keep still. Look up. I see Canis Major, for I will be your best friend who sticks closer than a brother. Look up. I see Orion's belt, for I have the belt of truth and the breastplate of righteousness and feet shod with preparation for the gospel of peace. Look up. He told her to keep looking up. And by, when the morning comes, when all the saints are gathered home, we'll tell the story of how we've overcome, and we'll understand it better by